My name is Daniele Villa and I am playwright and co-director of Sotteraneo, a contemporary theater and research group set up in Florence, Italy in 2005. I was asked to hold a masterclass about my work with the group Sotteraneo, and in order to do that, I'm gonna use some videos. Of course, everybody who works in theater knows that video kills around 80% of the beauty of a live performance. And some of these videos are quite old, but at least you're going to have the chance to see 20% of what I'm talking about. I was asked to talk about my role as a playwright, which is funny because I never really focus on this aspect of my work. And I was asked to give this speech in English, which is a bit less funny because in Italian I could sound a little bit smarter than this. But anyway, I do agree with the effort of developing some sort of European or maybe global citizenship, even throughout language. So English it is, let's do this.
Perché ci si sente al sicuro all'interno di e questo fa del riso uno strumento di conservazione sociale.
Sotteraneo, the group I work with, is a collective. At the very beginning, in 2005, we were just a bunch of friends working in a squat, for free, of course. And we decided not to have a director, not for ideological reasons. It's not that we thought it was the right way to set up a company. It was just the best way for us to cooperate. And since we didn't have a director, only one real distinction was left on the table. Four of us were going to perform on stage and one of us was going to stay outside. So four of us were going to improvise and rehearse during the creation process, and one of us was going to write stuff when needed. Although this distinction has always been not so rigid, because writing in Sotteraneo has always been some sort of shared territory within the members of the group. What I mean is that I do write everything for the group, but all the group works together in rewriting the stuff. It's a bit messy in the process. Sometimes it feels like writing for a bunch of editors that have different opinions and that disagree with each other, and you have to rewrite things in order to reach contradictory tasks, including my own. So there's something alchemical that really belongs to the story of the group and you cannot somehow explain or teach or transmit. I think that every group has to develop its own inner balance. It's a bit of a love story, actually, the way people can work together for a long time. And just like love stories, it can end anytime. Actually, it did end it partially, because two initial members of the group left Sotteraneo in 2012, and it was something we needed to process, not only emotionally but also about the method we were going to use from that day on. And we needed to process this so much that we also made a performance in which we performed some scenes for the very last times. That last time, pieces of the shows that we were going to put out of the repertory since this guy were leaving. And we were selling props and costumes of this show that were going lost. And at the very end of the performance, we were also throwing the unsold costumes and props into the garbage. Actually, not a very environmentally friendly finale for a performance. Things haven't totally changed being the three of us now. Of course, our idea of authorship is more mature, and of course, our inner balance and capacity of cooperation is maybe a little bit clearer. We defined some aspects of our roles during the time, but Sotteraneo is still a collective. And I'm going to try to explain the process we use to write as clear as I can. And I'm going to start with the what. What do we write about? And I'm going to split the what into 3 points. No classics, no characters / psychology, no story. Let's start from point one, no classics. We hardly ever work on classics. Once again, not for ideological reasons. We don't think it's just the right way to do it. We're not supposed to work or not work on classics. Although we do agree with the director Milo Rao, who says that theater needs to develop new classics throughout time. But the truth is we just hardly find a real personal urgency into a text that's already given. We need to start things from scratch. So the writing degree zero, so to speak, is also the creation degree zero and also the degree zero of the interpretation that actors are supposed to perform on stage. I start writing exactly when we start creating the whole show, not before. In this phase, actually, it's not really a degree zero, because what we do is choose a research field. It's usually a topic that we find interesting and urgent. And I feed this research field with references and theoretical horizons. In this phase, we could use the word dramaturg to define my job, but it's a word that barely nobody knows, at least in Italy, and it's a word that only insiders use, and often they use it with a different meaning. It also changes a lot depending on the country you're using it, so I'm not gonna use it. Let's stay with playwright. So, lexicon apart, what I do in this phase is basically build a conceptual map of references on the topic we're working on. References made with books, of course, essays and novels and whatsoever, graphic novels, but also movies, TV series, contemporary art pieces and video games and whatever could feed the imagery of the show. This kind of map feeds also our intuitions in order to find the dramaturgical structure for the show. Because if you don't use the story as a structure, then you need to find a different kind of structure, and it has to be and to feel compact and clear. This is the phase where I usually find myself saying to the others, guys, I think that we are really trying to talk about this, and the structure we could use could be that. The sooner I start making this kind of purposes to the others, the sooner we understand they are completely wrong, and the sooner we move towards the right one, the right ones. And all of this process always happen in a very collective modality where everybody really contributes to this kind of confrontation. This kind of mechanism started with one of our first shows. It was called Post-it. It was the year 2007. And looking at the video, we were quite younger than what we are right now. And the show was about caducity, or let's say the end of all things. It had a very simple structure. It was a show made with several scenes that just followed one another without any continuity solution, and having or not having texts, depending on the kind of scene we were acting. That's the first clip I'm gonna use.
Pochi minuti fa abbiamo ricevuto la notizia della morte di una persona a noi molto cara, per cui abbiamo deciso di andare in scena lo stesso, però vi chiederemmo di osservare tutti insieme un minuto di silenzio per questa persona prima di cominciare. Grazie. Grazie, possiamo cominciare.
Buonasera, la situazione è, diciamo, delicata. Diciamo che poteva andare peggio, tenuto conto di tutti i fattori, dell'entità dell'impatto, eccetera.
Non nascondo che c'è una remota possibilità e, attenzione, si tratta solo di una possibilità remota che d'altronde è nostro dovere tenere presente. Diciamo che c'è la recondita possibilità che si abbia a che fare con un permanere della problematica motore.
Ma rimane comunque la quasi certezza di uscire, di uscirne comunque sufficientemente soddisfatto. Non c'è niente da temere, c'è solo da aspettare che le cose si aggiustano, si potrebbe dire praticamente da sole nella quasi totalità dei casi.
So, second point of the what We write, the second point is no character slash psychology. We usually don't put characters on stage. We have more of a performative approach. So the performers are asked to build images or visions and to share signs with the audience, but without impersonating someone else, without having a psychological background with subtexts, intentions, or background story or whatsoever. We build shows that move usually on a presentation level rather than representation level, or more precisely, we usually move in between these two levels. Whenever our performers are asked to be a character in a show, it's probably just a matter of minutes before they stop being that specific persona and they start becoming someone else or something else. Because the reason of the things we act on stage is almost never internal, but mainly external. It's just a matter of what you are throwing towards the audience. In fact, I am lucky enough to always know who I am writing for, meaning I know who's the performer that's going to bring my words on stage. And because we already know the cast, and whenever I write, it's always some sort of compromise, but not really a compromise, more of something that can optimize the relationship within the imagery of the show, the things we want to say, and the mental and physical characteristics of the performer. That also allows me to enhance the characteristic of that specific performer, which is why we always think that texts should be written at the very edge of the stage, close to the rehearsal room. But actually, this is something you could have easily said about Shakespeare when he was writing for the Chamberlain's Man. So it's been like 400 years going on this way. But anyway, linguists teach us that language is never just the words. It's always the body and the proxemics and the paralinguistic stuff. So basically what I'm trying to say is that in Sotteraneo, the performers talk on stage only when we think it's really necessary. Otherwise, we let other kind of stuff and signs talk. Third and last point of the what we write, the point is no story. The dramaturgical structure we usually end up with is almost never a story. And with story, I mean it's not a line that goes from A to B with a cause-effect relationship system. The structure is always a little bit hybrid, so it may contain micro-narratives, but also pieces of information, extracts from conferences and stuff like that. So when I try to compose the dramaturgical structure and the text in it, it looks more like a tree with its branches than a line made with segments. And it's more horizontal than vertical, and it looks more like a patchwork of styles than a tale. Of course, we are perfectly aware that theater is a human medium, and that the human species is a narrative species. So as long as you put three disconnected elements to the attention of a spectator, he or she is going to try to connect those elements into a story. That's the basic mechanism that we inherit from evolution, and it made us survive into very hostile environments, so thumbs up for stories. But maybe this could be the very reason why it's interesting to investigate some other kind of mechanisms. And I think, for instance, that theater is more interesting as a tool than cinema, for example, to investigate some alternatives to our narrative automatism of the perception of reality. It also means that it allows us to create a show where references, images, and signs continuously change and mix up. And it makes, I think, we hope, of course, that's the idea, I think it makes it more stimulating for the attention of the audience, exactly because of this disorientation mechanism. Working this level, we usually set up a show made with different elements, somehow connected with each other. So it sets what the street artist Banksy usually calls an entry-level piece of art, meaning that you got different things and most of them are recognizable, and you can always find an access. And then the spectator has the freedom to choose how much into the deep he wants to go during the show and in the following days. But the idea is that if you start with different things and you don't know how they are connected, and all those things are part of your imagery, but they're continuously changing their meanings and their connections, it should be the kind of system that gives you the sense of uncanny that Freud was talking about, or at least that's the goal. And it also makes us funnier to work on the piece, because it allows us to put more or less whatever we like in the show, and then you start with whatever you like, but you have to make it consistent, organic, and clear. So the challenge is always to choose what really belongs to the show or not. With this kind of structure, I'm supposed to write connections rather than consequences. And this in order to create a counterintuitive plan of reality for the show. Counterintuitive hopefully doesn't mean cryptic, which is a completely different thing. But when we do work on this kind of process, the thing we like to think is that the spectator might be wondering, what the hell are they doing on stage and why are they doing that? And this because we think that we expect the spectator to be as much intelligent as we think we are. And just like us, when he comes to theater, we like to think that he or she is in desperate need for 1 hour of complexity. So the opposite experience of the everyday life, in which we adopt these automatic mechanisms of our brains that usually simplify reality in order to make us able to operate in a daily life scale, which is what neuroscientists call heuristics. But I am probably going out of topic here, so I'm going to put the next clip, which is a piece from Dies Irae, a show that we made in 2009. It was a show about the collapse of civilization. The show was built with a structure in five episodes about destruction and memory. And one of these episodes was an auction in which we were selling bags of dust of the most famous worldwide monuments.
These are the new seven wonders of the world.
Queste sono le sette meraviglie del mondo moderno.
Tonight, these new seven wonders of the world are going to be sold at an auction.
Stasera, queste nuove meraviglie del mondo saranno vendute all'asta.
It's going to be a reverse auction.
Sarà un'asta al ribasso.
So, for the new seven wonders of the world, the asking price is...
Quindi per le sette meraviglie del mondo moderno, il prezzo base d'asta è di...
1 million euro.
1 milione di euro.
Is anyone bidding 1 million euro?
Chi offre 1 milione di euro?
€600 taking the Christ Redeemer off the 42-yard tall statue of Rio de Janeiro.
€600 e togliamo il Cristo Redentore, la statua di 38 metri sopra Rio de Janeiro.
€5.
5 euro.
The same gentleman on bottom of the stalls knocks down the Colosseum for €5.
Signore, questo è una seduta, il Colosseo per 5 euro.
Stonehenge.
Ponte di Brooklyn.
Cremlino.
Torri Gemelle. Museo del Louvre.
Okay, we had 3 points for the what. Let's move on to the how. How I write with the group, and mainly how the group rewrites altogether what I just wrote. And also the how is split into 3 points. One, from the playwright to the actors. Second, direction, so to speak, from the actors to the playwright. And third and last direction, from actors and playwright to the page slash stage. Point one of the how, from the playwright to the actors, it basically works like this. I write a piece. It could be something that interests me, something I like, something I think it's urgent to say, or something I stole somewhere. Unfortunately, this is not the situation in which I talk about the theft as an artistic gesture, but anyway, it's something that I propose to the group, and they might say that it works, and they might even know better than me where to put it in the show. Or they might say it's nice, but there really is no place of the show where to put it. And when they say that, they are usually right, and I just have to give up that part of text. Or they might say they just don't like it, and even in this case, they're usually right, but in a more painful way. Point two of the how, from the actors to the playwright, it basically works like this. I transcribe something that emerged from the rehearsals. It might be an improvisation, it might be a discussion, it might be something we were reading or rehearsing. This kind of texts never come out ready. I always have to make, of course, interventions and adjustments. Because mainly because improvisation is nothing but a tool, and its capacity of focusing on things is limited. But it's really useful when it comes like this, because it comes straight from the actors, so it has urgency in it. And it's a bit the difference between having a blank page in front of you or having some kind of invisible hand that just wrote few lines on the paper, and you can start from that solid point and you feel that it's just going to work. Third and last direction for the how, from playwright and actors to the page slash stage. This happens when together we decide that we need a specific part of text somewhere in the show. It could be because it just works better, it could be because we need some kind of content, but somehow the show asks us for some specific text in a specific moment. And in this case, it works a bit like an inner commission. So we all decide together that I have to write a dialogue in which they talk about stuff they don't really understand, or I have to write a little lecture about the possible forms of the panda, or I have to write some tricky intellectual stuff just because it's the right thing to fit in that part of the show. With this kind of instructions, I just work on my own, I write the piece, and then I go back to the group and we rehearse it on stage. And there is where you understand if it works or not, because texts are must be written on stage. I think that throughout the actors, I think that Samuel Beckett said that, or Molière, I never really remember, but anyway, maybe they both said that. And an example of this could be a show that we made in 2010. The title was The Origin of the Species by Charles Darwin. It was a tricky situation because we were asked to work on a classic. And as I told you before, it's kind of hard for us to find ourselves into a classic. So we kind of cheated on the commission and we chose this masterpiece of biology and science. And we tried to transform it into a sequence of scientific visions. It was 2010. After the what and the how, it should be clear by now that in Sotteraneo's work, the writing is inseparable from the scenic writing. And with scenic writing, I mean the Italian scrittura scenica. I really struggled to translate this concept, and I hope I didn't get too far, but it means that you don't really write the text, that you write the show with the text in it. So I think it's kind of a common characteristic of the whole so-called post-dramatic theater. Whenever I think about the show, I don't necessarily think about the texts. And whenever I write something, it's just because I'm thinking about it as a part that I will put in a bigger system that's the whole show. But even if texts and words are not the matrix of our shows in Sotteraneo, we could never work without using language and words. Language is the core property of the human beings, or at least that's what Noam Chomsky said. That's what defines us as human beings, different from all the other animals. And even if language is not the center or the matrix of our work, it's still a very fundamental part of the overall syntax of the show. A resource that you could use also strongly when needed, but that you should use with you, that we use with caution, because it's a bit explicit. So we use text when we really need to say something. Otherwise, what we really like in theater, it's actually the unspoken. There is a short and beautiful essay by David Foster Wallace about the sense of humor in Kafka. David Foster Wallace explains that Kafka uses a lot the strategy of exformation, which is the opposite of information. And exformation is the removal of a certain amount of vital information inside a tale. And in fact, in Kafka's tales, we don't know where, usually, we don't know when. We really don't know who, also, and we don't know why. This kind of nonsense, super void, is something that Kafka himself found funny and Wallace found funny, and we happen to find really entertaining and intriguing. Actually, when you're watching a show, not understanding everything of what you're seeing is a very nice condition in which you could find yourself as a spectator. On the other hand, when we want to be perfectly clear while communicating with the audience, when we want to move beyond any possible kind of misunderstanding or misinterpretation, we usually use words. Of course, language is ambiguous too, and it's easy to misunderstand each other throughout language, but it's also the best tool that we have to be clear when we say something. So, as you can see, we don't start from the words and the texts. They're not the metrics of a show, but they really are a fundamental part of the chemical formula that helps us to create peace. It's really the perfect reagent of the formula, because it links things together, it explains concepts when you need to be clear, and it make it wider on a theoretical level. So it's the reagent we want to use. We would never give up on using words. It's just that sometimes you need a lot of it, a lot of these chemical elements. Sometimes just a few drops are going to be enough. Thing is, whenever we think about our texts, I think that if you read our texts without seeing the show, they would probably make no sense. But at the same time, if you read our texts without watching the show, you might get curious about what happens to those words in the actual show. And I might be curious about what a different director could do with those words in a completely different piece of theater. Maybe they would adapt to different environments.
Ha ha ha!
Having this kind of approach to the writing work, there is a pretty clear consequence, and it's that styles are variables. So we do write, I do write different things in different styles because we together decide that we need different things in different styles. The only thing that's always there somehow is what the American writer Raymond Carver defined the tone. The tone is, I mean, the way that your words and your texts reveal your point of view on the world, your point of view on the things you're talking about. Even if you try to hide your opinion, just like we do in every single show, even if you try to make it complicated to understand where you are in your own show, the tone gets through anyway. There's no escape from that. And we are now, after 15 years, quite aware that our tone could be defined, just to make it very, very simple, technique and humoristic. So we usually use a language that's very surgical and funny somehow, and ironic about the reality we're putting on stage. And the main goal with this is that we like to activate more an analytical reaction in the viewer than an emotional one. We like to cool down the scenes and the theme in order to trigger this kind of rational look. And then we don't avoid being emotional. We like when emotions break into the piece, but we like it at most when it's some kind of collateral effects of the collective thinking process. That's why, more than characters and stories, we use images and pieces of information. We want to dismantle the imagery collective we're working on, and we want to create this kind of detachment reaction about things throughout irony and throughout the non-narrative approach, in order to question our perception of reality and the relativity of reality itself. Warning: the relativity of the perception that we have of reality. With this, I don't mean that there is no reality at all, or that truth is always an invention. These kind of statements are something I personally strongly disagree with. Reality is there, and you only have to make the effort to analyze it. And the thing that Umberto Eco, the Italian writer Umberto Eco, called the hard core of reality is really difficult to reach. It's that level of objectivity of the things of the world is a very difficult place to reach, and it costs a lot of effort. And theater is some kind of place where you go to make this kind of effort, even because the closer you get to that hardcore of reality, the more it gets in, it transforms into a battlefield within people, ideology, beliefs, and whatsoever. We could say that when I write with irony, and when the actors of Sotteraneo perform something in an ironic way, or when our shows and texts are funny and make people laugh, it's not really to make things easier, but actually the contrary. Maybe it makes things more accessible, more enjoyable. Maybe it also makes things more fluid for the flow of attention of the audience, but really the task is to mess things up with meanings. It might be a relief on the chemical level of the audience brains, but the thing we like to achieve is when you get them confused about what they are laughing at and why. Or at least that's the idea. The idea is to write texts and create shows that works like traps. You easily get inside and then they click and you have to figure out what's going on. And an example for that could be Homoridens, a show that we made in 2005. It was a show about the mechanism of laughter, as the title in Latin says. And the contract within the company and the audience was pretty clear. We were running a test, just like in a scientific focus group, and the spectators were the guinea pig. Of course, they were aware of it, so they were capable to refuse the provocation somehow. And we were basically trying to make them laugh about more or less everything. At the end of this video, three last quick things that I really care about, and the third last is audience involvement. In almost all of our shows, almost all, we use some kind of direct activation of the audience. It's nothing like spontaneous actions or self-expression or participation the way they did it in the 70s performance. It's always something close to a switch, just a switch. Like a yes or no question that one spectator has to answer to, or a decision that one or more spectators have to make in a certain moment. that this kind of intervention is always limited. There's always a rhythm of the show that we want to protect that can include this kind of variables. But there is always this little area where things can be changed by one or more spectators doing or saying something. These things, of course, influences the syntax, the complex syntax of the show, and therefore the writing. Because basically every show is written for the audience, but it's completely different when you write to address the audience, to talk directly towards them. So you have to be as clear, as simple as you can in order to be sure that they understood you. It has to be a very surgical question or choice in order not to activate some kind of free action from the spectator. The margins of interpretation have to basically disappear. So how to write a question for one spectator, how to propose an action for the whole audience, how to ask them to raise their hands or not, being sure that they absolutely understood the question. This has a lot to do with our obsession with language and misunderstandings, truth and post-truth, misperceptions of reality, and in the end, with our obsession of questioning the possibility of actually share some level of reality. And the next clip is a show that we made in 2013. It was called Binormal, and it used a lot of this kind of mechanism of interaction with the audience. He had a structure that was, let's say, an impossible day, from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., punctuated by a clock, with a man and a woman that were being every possible woman and man, striving to survive physically and economically in very neurotic and precarious daily life.
Nata nel 1920.
tardi, è il momento di impugnare le munizioni che vi abbiamo dato e di prepararsi al lancio. Aspettate il mio segnale, però intanto cercate di caricare con il braccio e di mirare ai bersagli. Mirate l'alto per non colpire chi vi sta davanti, ma lanciate con forza, voglio vederli crollare. Quando chiederò fuoco, voglio che urliate e colpiate questi cazzo di vecchi. Il campo deve ricominciare a scorrere. Non esistono soluzioni pacifiche. I figli devono succedere ai padri. Voi siete Edipo. E rinforzatevi. Calmare. Puntare. Fuoco!
Chapter of my tale, I would call it icons. As I said before, we hardly work on classics, but we do use classic icons or pop icons, any kind of icon actually. We kidnap icons to put them into our pieces. We made it with Charles Darwin, as I mentioned before. We made it with David Foster Wallace, but also Hamlet, Joan of Arc, Adolf Hitler, and William Shakespeare. Once again, that's the kind of mechanism that we use to use the collective imagery. We like to use the things that we all know, or more precisely, that we all think we know, and dismantle them and then reunite them in a very personal way. And on this kind of project, just 2 years ago, the group made me write the first monologue I ever wrote. I'm not much into monologues, and it's actually not a real monologue. It's a biopic of William Shakespeare's life. And we got William Shakespeare himself on stage. It's an actor impersonating the bard, but he's not alone, because we also have our three voiceovers making him questions. It's the kind of technique that we call impossible interview, and it's quite famous in Italy because of the radio project made with different famous writers, Calvino, Eco, Manganelli, Arbasino. They wrote many impossible interviews to many characters from the history of humankind. And we chose to talk with Shakespeare. And the idea was to build the story of his life and his hard work, but talking directly with him. It took a long research work behind this 1 hour monologue. There are dozens of books and websites and documentaries. We also made a trip to London and Stratford-upon-Avon. But in the end, all of this overdose of information made me write a very, very long list of questions that I would like to ask Shakespeare. And then write a very, very long list of answers that the actual Shakespeare could have answered us. Thing is, while I was writing that, I realized that we didn't want it to be purely philological. We did need Shakespeare to talk about our time and to be somehow related to the theater we watch nowadays. So in the very end, we have a non-monologue, which is a biopic, but pretty docu-fictional. But I do think that after that 1 hour of chat with Shakespeare, the audience have the feeling of having met somehow William Shakespeare, or at least one version of it. Oh, or at least one version of him, sorry.
Si dice spesso che il teatro è un luogo di fantasmi, perché sul palco puoi evocare anche cose o persone che non esistono.
I wonder if you're lonesome tonight. You know, someone said, all the world is a stage, and we each must play a part. fate. Let me plain and love you as my sweetheart.
Benvenuti a Shakespeareology, una chiacchierata impossibile con Sir William Shakespeare. Ok, William, allora parliamo della tua carriera. Di come si fa a diventare il più grande teatrante di tutti i tempi.
Ecco, questo è un ottimo punto di vista sulle cose.
Se una trama è già buona, tanto vale copiarla. Noi siamo drammaturghi! Quello che ci serve è azione, personaggi, tempo, spazio!
Io credo che se fossi vivo oggi farei cinema. Scriverei dei gran blockbuster d'autore per sbancare il botteghino. Complessi ma popolari. Però adesso invece devo dire che sono contento di stare qui. Anzi, grazie, è bello tornare in vita. Anche se soltanto per 52 minuti.
Dannato! Grida per primo, basta!
Ok, William, Londra, ricompari nel 1592 in una recensione dell'epoca.
Eccomi finalmente per le strade della Big City, affollate e rumorose.
It's astounding.
Time is fleeting. Madness takes its toll. But listen closely.
Not for very much longer.
I've got to keep control.
C'è chi dice che forse non sei stato tu a scrivere le tue opere.
No, ragazzi. No. Che delusione. Anche voi con questa storia che Shakespeare non ha scritto Shakespeare. Peccato perché mi stavate quasi simpatici.
Last but not least point, the title could be Philosophy in Action. That was a definition used once by a university professor to define our work, and I always quote it because you don't get to say that about yourself, but if someone else said that, then you can use it, even because it's one of the best compliments I think we have ever received. And it really explains the way we work, because it's some sort of sharing thoughts throughout the live condition of theater, instead of telling stories and stuff like that. And a good example of this thing and all the things I've been annoying you with could be the show called Overload. We made it in 2017 and it collects all of the aspects I've been trying to explain. So I will take it as a case study and as the last chapter of this story. We started for Overload in 2016. The starting point was really abstract, visual, almost choreographic, because it was what we call the interrupted action, meaning an actor who's loading the greatest amount of energy preparing for an action, and then he or she interrupts himself before doing that action. When the starting point is so abstract and visual, my job is usually to find a theoretical horizon to explain the thing to ourselves in the first place. And I started reading a lot of stuff about attention span and cognitive fluency. And that's the point where I find myself telling the other guys, maybe we want to talk about this and we could do it this way. And studying this stuff, I stumbled into the news that the new digital media would have reduced the human average attention span to 9 seconds, which means below the average attention span of a goldfish. Of course, that was an amazing story, but it was also fake news, that, and we discovered it to be fake in about 48 hours. But those 48 hours believing in this story made us realize that that was exactly the topic we wanted to talk about, the lowering of attention and the perception of this in the digital age. So once we have we had the topic, we realized that we wanted to have a structure that was that could be close to an hypertext, so a show that was going to divide into several possible paths. And trying to build this hypertext, we realized that we needed a center of gravity of the whole mechanism, some kind of center point where we could listen to something and from which we could get distracted. And I proposed to use the American writer David Foster Wallace as the center of gravity of the piece, because we love Wallace, of course, but also because he was the right icon to kidnap. Since Wallace was obsessed with the mass media and their capacity of influence our daily life, because he had this avant-pop approach combining philosophy and comedy, and because of his imagery and so on. So he was the right guy to put in the center of the show. So we had the basic structure, Wallace in the middle talking, and different scenes opening like a hypertext. And we wanted the audience to decide whether to activate those scenes or to continue listening to David Foster Wallace. Once again, the audience doesn't decide what happens, doesn't decide how things happen. They only decide whether to shift the attention and to change what's going on in the show. So we needed to communicate it in the simplest and clearest possible way, and I wrote, I think, the shortest and clearest sentence I could to explain the mechanism. So only one piece of the puzzle was missing. What the hell is David Foster Wallace talking about? At the time, we were reading a lot of essays about neuroscience stuff and philosophical books about the ecology of attention. So we thought that David Foster Wallace could give us a 1 hour speech on these topics. And in this case, my job is pretty simple. I have to lock myself up in a room for 5-10 days with 20 different books about attention span and neuroscience, and full of underlines and bookmarks. And I have to write 1 hour speech thinking that the guy who's talking is David Foster Wallace, and then I give it to the group and we rehearse it together on stage, me being outside and them being on stage. Thing is, in that specific circumstance, the text didn't work at all. I could think that it was because of me, because the text didn't work itself, because I wrote it wrong. And that might be true, but I like to think more that it was not the right text that we need to use for that situation, because of its complexity of topics and most of all because of its discontinuity within the things we were talking about. So we reversed, as I told you before, the mechanism of writing, and the inner commission took over. So the actors told me that they thought we needed a tale, something narrative, that David Foster Wallace could have talked about one day of his life. And I did agree with the idea of shifting to the narrative form, but I totally disagree with the idea of David Foster Wallace being autobiographic. Once again, I have to say my colleagues were right, because I locked myself up for 5-10 days, this time with the Wallace's biography and his essays and novels and blah, blah, blah. And discussing with the others, we ended up with the idea of Wallace telling us about his last day, the day he committed suicide. So we had all the structure, the center of gravity, Wallace. We knew what he was talking about. We knew the mechanism of the show. We only needed to choose all the scenes we had and connect them with the tale that Wallace was giving us. And it was kind of a trap mechanism that was capable to feed itself while we were discovering it. And it was a very complicated process. It took 1 year and we got lost many times, sometimes even worried because we were not trying the right solution. But in the end, it was worth it. It's one of the shows that we made that we like the most and we're most proud of. So I'm gonna leave you with the trailer of Overload, and I hope some of you will get the chance to see it as soon as the COVID restrictions allow us once again to perform this show. I think that's all. Thank you for listening.
Io sono uno scrittore. Sono americano. Nord americano.
Ed è esattamente di questo che vorrei parlarvi stasera. Vorrei parlarvi della possibilità di una vita reale nell'epoca della saturazione delle informazioni. Più semplicemente vorrei raccontarvi di una mia giornata di settembre di qualche anno fa.
Sono dei collegamenti che servono ad attivare dei contenuti nascosti che verranno sempre introdotti da questo suono. Ogni volta che vedrete uno di questi segnali avrete 10 secondi di tempo per scegliere se continuare ad ascoltare il telefono oppure visualizzare il contenuto.
She wore blue velvet, bluer than velvet was the night, softer than satin was the light from the stars. She wore blue. Warmer than May, her tender sighs, love was all.
E quanti contenuti nascosti sono stati attivati fino a questo momento? Secondo voi adesso sta accadendo qualcosa? Quanto ci mette un palco deserto a diventare noioso?
I still can see blue bells.